A desperate and painstaking rescue operation is underway after a massive explosion in Roselle.
Blew me straight out of bed, onto my feet.
As you're running out, the floor's just falling in behind you. Ceiling's coming down.
What happened here in the early hours of the 4th of September 2014 was frightening.
There was just flames, there was shrapnel.
And horrific.
Shattered windows, and you could just hear the building collapsing.
A mother and her baby boy are among those feared trapped in the rubble.
Firefighters did their best, but this blast was so ferocious, nothing could save 27-year-old Chris Noble, 31-year-old Bianca O'Brien, and her beautiful 11-month-old son, Jude. One man, Adeel Khan, was pulled from the rubble, injured but alive. At first, he claimed to be a victim.
Who burnt down the property?
I have no clue.
But now we know he's a killer.
He planned it, he knew what he was doing.
Khan deliberately blew up his convenience store because he wanted to claim a $225,000 insurance payout.
He knew we were up there. Chris's car was parked out front.
It's just horrific. He's an evil man.
For the people living above Adeel Khan's shop, the evening before the blast was as normal as any other. Sunset beers for flatmates Todd Fisher, Corey Cameron and Chris Noble.
Hello, darling.
The sportsman's son of Liz and Ross.
Incredibly tough, physically strong, but had a heart of gold. They're lovely memories to have. Lovely memories.
Next door, Anthony Carroll was eating a quick meal he'd just bought from Adeel Khan's shop.
Bought myself a can of Coke and some chips, as I did most nights.
And it was family time in the neighbouring flat for Bianca and John O'Brien with their baby Jude, a beloved first grandchild for Bianca's dad, Bill.
This is the last time I saw this little boy. We had a little power nap on the sofa. And his father came to pick him up to take him home, and that's the last I saw him.
When you see the layout of the Roselle building, it's clear how it became such a death trap. At ground level is the convenience store. Directly above it, in a three-bedroom apartment, lived good mates Corey, Todd and Chris. Their neighbour on this side of the building was Anthony. On the other side lived John and Bianca with their baby son Jude, though on this particular day, John had to leave them to get to work early. It's now 4 o'clock in the morning and, as you'd expect, everyone is sleeping, blissfully unaware that for the past 5 hours, Adeel Khan had been preparing his store for a catastrophic explosion. Wearing a mask against the fumes, he used between 20 and 30 litres of fuel to make petrol bombs, which he placed in all three major rooms of his store. He then packed paper and cardboard around them to make them even more flammable. And he created one long continuous wick with petrol-laden rags tied together. Khan then left the building, making sure to close the door behind him to protect himself before lighting the fuse. The force of the fire is extraordinary, hurling Khan almost 3 metres back into the alley and shaking the very foundations of the building.
The cracking of electricity, there was the crumbling of the building, there was the twisted metals.
Anthony woke, confused and disorientated, rushing to put on his prosthetic leg and get out.
The fire brigade turned up and then there was the police and all the other emergency services.
First, I thought it was a massive gas explosion.
Todd and Corey were also woken by this hellish nightmare.
I was like, I need to get out of here. And then the floor started to sink through like a sinkhole. So I jumped over my bed and when I went to get to the door, the ceiling fell on top of me. And I was like, oh shit, this is not good. And then I got, went into him next door, opened the door, got him, he didn't know what was going on.
Ran by Chris's room and he's, Chris, let's go. Come on. He said, I'm coming.
Yeah, we could hear him. I couldn't open the door. I was trying to open the door. And then I let go of the door because I thought maybe he's trying to get out as I'm trying to open it. So I let go, but I wasn't panic or anything from him, was it? It was just, I'm coming.
It's awful to imagine the terror that was experienced here. Believing Chris was not far behind them, Todd and Corey raced to their only exit, which turned out to be a jammed glass sliding door. Todd smashed his way through it. With no other way out, they then had to jump 1.5 metres onto a neighbouring rooftop to safety.
We got out and then we jumped off over the balcony down to the road and we checked each other and we went, shit, Chris is not with us.
This is the moment Corey and Todd realise Chris is lost to them.
Getting you in and out the back.
What we don't see is Corey scrambling back onto the balcony of the burning, crumbling building to try to save his mate.
I'm just screaming for him and you could hear him just, you know, struggling for life. And
as soon as we got out, though, the whole thing was engulfed in flames. It's like literally 5 seconds after we got out. So if we didn't get out that, we would have been dead. There's no way.
Just the most hopeless feeling, you know. When you hear him, you can't do anything about it, you know, so.
It was early morning in Chris's hometown of Canoundra in country New South Wales.
I went across the kitchen to put the jug on and I could see that there was a message on my phone and had a look and it said, I love you. And my stomach immediately just lurched. And then I thought, no, you're being an over-anxious mother. Don't be like that. So I sent a message back to him. What are you doing awake at this time? Then when I didn't get a reply or anything for him, I thought, oh. So I turned the Today Show on and they had this fire in Darling Street and I thought, gee, that looks close to where Chris is. So send him a message, you know, the fire looks really close to you. Are you all right?
It was a message Chris would never read. Trapped in his burning bedroom with his door jammed and bars on his window, he had time only to say goodbye.
How much does that haunt you, that he was very aware that this was the end for him?
A lot. Because you wonder, you know, how long was he alive after he'd sent the message? And you think, why wasn't he getting out? And felt that it wasn't good enough to get a message like that from somebody at the last bit. But then you remember how much he just loved so many people. He was known for saying, I love you, to his mates, to his friends, to his brother, to his sister, that I can't believe that you can be that strong to actually do that when, you know, there's so much noise and disaster all around you.
Just on the other side of Chris's bedroom, another tragedy was unfolding. His neighbours, Bianca and Jude, mother and child, were also trapped.
Help! Anyone, help!
Did she die quickly? Did the fumes get her? Did the smoke get her? Did she burn? Always there. Did I consider? Always there. Peck, I hope you really didn't suffer. That's always with me.
But Bill Karamalewski clings to a more comforting memory that right to the end, Bianca was a loving mother.
They found them in the rubble with Bianca on top of Jude, holding Jude, protecting Jude. There's no words that I can tell you how we felt and how the family felt. There's no words that you can say.
Hang on, there's someone here.
Adeel Khan too could have so easily been killed by the blast. But he who deserved it least was protected from the explosion.
Tell me your name. What's your name?
Paramedics found him beneath the rubble.
I mean, when you discovered that the man who lit this explosion, who made this happen, survived, and your friend didn't, what was that moment like?
I felt sick. Yeah, he felt sick, but no, I'm glad he survived. Because I want him to live, you know, knowing what he did. You know, I feel like if he died, that would have been the easy way out for him. You know, because they wouldn't have saved him unless we told them that there was more guys over there.
So that's why you feel guilty again, because you've saved his life, but you can't save your best mate's life.
I mean, I would live in the same community again, because it's just, it's a great community.
It's taken a long time for Corey Cameron and Todd Fisher to return to the place of the tragedy, their former home, which is now a construction site. Loving can
hurt. I guess for you both, you have experienced the best of times here in Roselle and the very worst of times. What is it like to come back?
You get that sick feeling in your stomach?
Yeah, I mean, right now, like, it's just tough.
There are many tough parts. Remembering the horror of the fire. Remembering their lost friend, 27-year-old Chris Noble.
Just hearing them, you know, it's just that worst feeling. I've never had worse, just hopelessness. You know, when you just feel you could do nothing about it, it's just so painful.
What makes an already terrible situation worse is that the man responsible, Adeel Khan, continues to claim he didn't do it.
Did you burn down your shop?
No.
And has concocted a preposterous explanation for the explosion.
You said last night that one of them showed you a gun. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Unbelievably, Khan claims three men came into his convenience store, tied him up, robbed him, and then for some unknown reason, stuck around for 5 hours preparing to blow up his shop.
They took my money, wallet, cell phone.
One of the things that really to me that he was so that arrogant that he thought that ordinary Australian people would actually believe the garbage that he came up with for a start.
I just can't get my head around how anybody could be that selfish.
He studied, he planned. He's got ice going through his veins, this guy.
The moment that he lit that wick or fuse, what happened?
Would have been incredible. First off, you've got an intense fireball that erupts with it, thousands of degrees in temperature, that then impacts on combustible material, causing it to ignite.
And how quickly would that have happened?
Seconds.
Arson investigator Greg Kelly has been combing through the ashes of suspicious fires for more than 30 years.
You've obviously got evidence of an explosion, which is not natural to a fire scene. That would always have the hairs up on the back of the neck saying, OK, something's not right here.
Ty, sick on.
As in most suspicious fires...
Good boy.
..at Roselle, police used sniffer dogs, quickly identifying that Khan used petrol to blow up his shop. They retrieved fragments of the milk crates and the cardboard and paper he used to make his petrol bombs. They even found the lighter he used to set the place on fire.
How often does the arsonist believe, well, there's no way you're going to catch me because all the evidence gets burnt in the fire itself?
I'd say pretty often, actual fact, and that's one of the benefits we have with fire investigation is the fact that not all the evidence is destroyed all the time.
And mounting evidence at his obliterated store pointed directly to the clumsy Khan. He was at the scene with a face mask in his pocket, and his business was on the brink of going bust. But the real breakthrough in the case came through the help of modern technology.
The police reviewed something like 1,000 hours of footage. That's a lot of painstaking work to identify what's happened. They did a good job of locking it all up and getting the evidence together.
Here, he's captured on CCTV, trying to hide while he fills jerry cans with 38 litres of petrol from a service station he's never used before. In court, Khan's crazy explanation was that he bought the petrol for an experiment. He wanted to see if he could make fuel last longer by mixing it with water.
They just tied me and put a rubbish bag on my eyes.
Khan continued his outlandish claims. He told the court that in the moments before the blast, he'd been able to make a miraculous escape from the three mysterious armed robbers who'd held him captive.
Both look Italian or Greek.
So we've got one African or Aboriginal.
Yeah.
And then one Italian or Greek. Or,
yeah.
And the other one was European of some type.
Yeah.
What was it like for you to go to court every day?
Torture, punishment. For sitting through and looking at a person that killed your children and destroyed your family. Maybe it would have been different. It wouldn't have changed, but still would have been different if he came out and said, you know what, look, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to kill these people. But for him to say and deny everything and come up with these stories, oh, it's horrible. He wanted to walk, this guy, so much he wanted to walk. Look at this guy.
This is a precious moment now frozen in time, a sad and sweet reminder of 11-month-old Jude.
He was a gorgeous boy.
To Bill Karamilewski, his grandson will always be this happy, bouncing baby boy.
So much laughing, smiling, dominated our household. Look at him. I miss him so much. I miss him so much.
Seems like your questions are around being that I have done something wrong.
What do you think of the lie?
Well, people come up with the most outrageous lies because they haven't had time to prepare for them.
So he had time to prepare for the fire.
Mm-hmm.
You don't think he prepared the lie?
No, he didn't think it was going to go that way.
He didn't think he'd get caught?
No, he didn't think he'd be there at the time of the fire.
Forensic psychiatrist Julian Parmigiani believes Khan will most likely never tell the truth.
The psychopaths divide the world into two types of people, the predators and the victims. And they see themselves as predators and the victims are victims, and they've only got themselves to blame for being victims.
So if that's who Adeel Khan is, will he ever feel remorse for what's happened?
If he were a psychopath, then he wouldn't care.
You're just trying to blame me about the whole incident.
He's dragged this out for 2 years. He's lied. Admit it, I'm guilty, I'm sorry. I didn't mean for this to happen. I didn't mean for it to be this big. But he didn't do that.
For Anthony Carroll, along with fellow survivors, Corey Cameron and Todd Fisher, Liz and Ross Noble, and Bill Kemerlewski, the day of the verdict was a day they all hoped for justice.
The accused has never expressed any remorse or sorrow for the lives taken, and that has been really, really difficult for us.
The jury found Khan guilty of the murder of Chris Noble, who lived directly above the shop.
Chris was loved by so many people. We will miss everything about him every day for the rest of our lives.
But for Bianca and Jude, the jury settled on the lesser charge of manslaughter because the family lived next door to Khan's shop, not directly above it.
We sat and we looked at each other and we started to cry, you know, because we felt empty. You killed these people, man. Your actions killed these people. There's no manslaughter, murder. You are guilty of killing these people.
Hello, darling. It's like a hole. There's a whole big hole missing.
All right, love you.
Love you.
There's a joy gone.
And all because of a selfish act. Don't wish it on anybody.
Chris's childhood friend, Todd Fisher, who suffered horrific injuries when he leapt from the burning building, has now returned to the family's farm in Canoundra.
Get up!
But he and Corey Cameron still struggle with what happened.
It's been about, you know, almost 2 years, and, you know, you still think about it every day.
Go. Sit.
I don't sleep very much. You think about how bad flashbacks. I remember when I first got back out home, I'd wake up in the middle of the night and the first thing, I'd be out a window, trying to get out a window, just nightmares and just, like, terrors.
Loving can heal. Loving can mend your soul.
The brutal reality is that even with such tragic loss, life goes on.
Oh, there you are. Rick, have a shot at your left foot.
But thankfully, even in the face of such a hateful act, love will ultimately endure.
Every person that met Bianca walked away with a thought that this girl is special. She had a smile that'll brighten up this room. So you can keep me. He was her life. She was so proud, like I was with her. She was so proud of this little boy.
And Bianca and her little boy Jude will live on, cherished by her family and remembered by her community.
During those dark times and during those dark hours and dark days, I saw a ray of sunshine in those dark ages. And it came from strangers. Strangers. There are so many good people that emerge when a tragedy like this happens, and you see in this world, you know what, it's not such a bad world. There's a lot of good people there. That's what keeps us going.
Hello, I'm Tara Brown. Thanks for watching. To keep up with the latest from 60 Minutes Australia, make sure you subscribe to our channel. You can also download the 9Now app for full episodes and other exclusive 60 Minutes content.